Hello and welcome to another video from the Cross the Rubicon channel. We hope you're enjoying the channel and the content so far. We're pleased to have with us today a guest who is going to talk to us about what the government doesn't want you to know about e-cars. Please enjoy the video. Thank you.
Hi everyone. First of all, I'd like to thank Cross the Rubicon for letting me use this channel to talk to you about what the government doesn't want you to know about electric vehicles or EVs. I will touch on the production of EVs and will question whether the current New Zealand Labour government's plans to add a tax on petrol vehicles while subsidizing EVs is actually helping the environment or hurting it and their citizens. Now they will say, it's not a tax. It's an incentive to buy zero or low emission cars. But let's be real, it's a tax. Plus, it's a tax that affects lower income earners who cannot afford to buy expensive new EVs, even with a government subsidy. It will put up the price of food and other goods that are currently transported or produced with the use of traditional vehicles. Tradies, plumbers, electricians, carpenter and the like, mainly use petrol vehicles, and charges for their services will go up to cover the extra tax. The working poor, who use their car all day long to go from job to job, such as community nurses, carers, cleaners, gardeners, and others, all need to use their car for work. Most will not be able to afford a new vehicle, and few will be given a company car to use. Using the bus is not an option as they travel with their tools they need for their work, travel throughout the day, and often to places there is no bus service. Bus services are also not available for night shift workers, and even in the daytime, buses don't travel to many large places of employment, such as warehouses and factories. I doubt workers' wages will go up to cover the costs of the tax. So the question is, will they be able to continue their work? Or will they be forced to find some other form of employment? Is labor really for the poor working class? I'll let you think about that a moment. Let's look at EVs. It's true they don't emit any fumes when in operation, and at the moment they are cheaper to run, but that may not always be the case when demand for power goes up as more people buy electric vehicles. The price of power is likely to go up with the greater demand. Also, as our population increases, there will be even greater demand for power. So, where will that extra power come from? Hydro is considered clean, but can have devastating effects on the environment. And of late, the water levels in some of our hydro lakes have been very low at times. So the future of existing sources of power is not always reliable. Or we may need to restrict ourselves on usage, which is a problem as most of our heating and cooking is electric. Do we then need to go back to carbon-producing fires and gas to keep warm in the winter? New Zealand has a long history of being nuclear-free, so that is not a source of power. And burning coal to produce electricity to power clean cars would be completely counterproductive to the whole effort. Solar panels are very expensive, and it's questionable whether they pay for themselves before they need replacing. And then, what do you do with the spent panels? Dump them in a landfill? Wind farms have been popping up around the country, but internationally, millions of birds and bats are maimed and killed by the turbine blades as they are placed in areas that have strong wind currents that birds also like to take advantage of. Wind turbines are also a huge eyesore to a country that relies on tourism for its economy. The amount of power created by wind is also a question as to whether it is enough for our needs. So again, where will the electricity come from? Something else to think about. Along with the subsidy the government plans on giving to those that purchase EVs, there's also the question of whether EVs will be contributing to the maintenance and development of our roads, or if that will be shouldered by petrol vehicles alone. This would be another benefit for those higher income earners who can afford a new subsidized electric vehicle. Petrol tax is meant to be used to fix existing roads and to build new roads, Where will the funds come from for this if more and more of our vehicles are electric? Another new tax, maybe? Let's look at the production of EVs, something that has been missing in the public conversation so far. The big difference with electric vehicles from regular ones is the battery that provides the power. Here is a popular style of EV battery. This is the same type of battery that you find in your cell phone and many battery-operated appliances, e-bikes, e-scooters, only much, much larger, as you can see. This is an image of how it is placed in a car, running along the length of the vehicle under the seating area. Again, thinking of your phone, you know the life of your battery decreases with time, so how long will the battery of an EV last? Nissan is currently providing additional battery capacity loss insurance coverage for 5 years or 60,000 miles, although the battery is meant to last 8 to 10 years. How much will a new battery cost? It's hard to say, as the industry claims they're getting cheaper all the time, but as of 2017, it could be $5,500 and up in U.S. dollars, plus several hundred U.S. dollars for installation fees, all depending on the make and model. Something to remember when thinking of buying a secondhand EV. Another aspect of these batteries is that they can be highly combustible. Remember the problem Samsung had with one of their phones suddenly bursting into flames for no reason. It was a problem with the battery, the same used in electric vehicles. The industry and the media have been very quiet about this important safety issue, making it hard to know how far along they are in solving this problem. This photo was taken by a security camera in China in 2019. The left side shows the car smoking before bursting into flames, and on the right, the flames are so bright it is hard to make out the car at all. I wonder what has happened to the other cars in the building. And here is one from July 2019 in Canada, where the car exploded just sitting in a garage, sending the garage door across the street and creating a huge hole in the roof. Good thing no one was in the car and there was no living space above the garage. Here's a fun fact. Although lithium batteries are said to be 95% recyclable, to make these very large batteries safe, it has made them very difficult and uneconomical to recycle them. I will now read excerpts from a few articles to give some basic facts regarding these batteries. My intention is to offer another side that seems to be left out of the whole argument for low-emission vehicles. It will in no way be complete, and I hope that listeners will do their own research so they in turn can feel confident to open up the discussion on electric cars and the environment. I will leave links in the description to a few that I have referenced. According to Wikimedia, most electric vehicle batteries are lithium-based and rely on a mix of cobalt, manganese, nickel, and graphite, and other primary components. Some of these materials are harder to find than others, though none should be classified as rare earth metals. There are important issues surrounding battery production that must be acknowledged and addressed. For example, over 60% of the global supply for cobalt comes from the Democratic Republic of Congo, which has a poor human rights track record. International organizations have denounced for years the exploitative labor practices involved in cobalt production. I would add, there's a good chance you already own something powered in part by cobalt coming from a mine like the ones in these pictures. From the article called Nickel Mining: The Hidden Environmental Costs of Electric Cars, this additional scrutiny has largely focused on ethical concerns with cobalt and lithium supply chains, despite Tesla CEO Elon Musk's observation last year that the lithium-ion batteries his vehicles use are mostly made of nickel and graphite, with lithium itself merely the salt on the salad. But the extraction of nickel, predominantly from mined in Australia, Canada, Indonesia, Russia, and the Philippines, comes at an environmental and health cost. Plumes of sulfur dioxide choking the skies, churned earth blanketed in cancerous dust, rivers running blood red, environmental campaigners have painted a grim picture of the nickel mines and smelters feeding the electric vehicle industry. The Philippines this year closed or suspended 17 nickel mines because of environmental concerns. That was an extract from The Guardian. Let's look more closely at these environmental issues concerning nickel. Any pollution in our rivers will end up in the ocean, therefore affecting the globe. Air pollution and the health problems associated with it can be carried by the wind for miles and miles, affecting all in its path. Cancerous dust harms the miners, their families, and the health system, if they have one in their country. Habitat destruction for all living things doesn't need any additional explanation. Plus, nickel deposits are typically found in low-grade ores of 1 to 2% nickel, thus using a lot of energy to extract and refine the metal. Plus, with the huge trucks and equipment used in the mining process itself, a lot of greenhouse gases are produced in the obtaining of this metal. Battery production is not looking very environmentally friendly so far. Now, excerpts from engineering.com. Here's something that electric car companies do not want you to know. The materials that make up your car battery are born deep in mines, may be extracted by child labor in some of the most polluting ways possible. Even if the mining industry were ecologically sustainable, lithium-ion batteries have been known to explode and or catch fire. Avoiding such incidences, the batteries are extremely difficult to recycle, often resulting in the disposal of a spent but still toxic and flammable battery in your local landfill. In some regions in Chile, a major producer of lithium, 65% of water is used up in lithium production, diverting it from local food production. The brine then requires 12 to 18 months to evaporate. Any water returned to the farmers could be tainted with chemicals. That's from a 2015 report from the US-based Union of Concerned Scientists on battery-powered electric vehicles. The result is stunning. Manufacturing a battery-powered electric vehicle, or BEV, adds an entire ton of greenhouse gases to the atmosphere more than a gasoline vehicle. I'll repeat that. Manufacturing a battery-powered electric vehicle adds an entire ton of greenhouse gases to the atmosphere more than a gasoline vehicle. Perhaps more shocking is that the total carbon footprint of a BEV is not zero. It's half of what it is for the total lifespan of a gasoline vehicle. Now, consider the cost of water loss in South American farmers, child labor in the Congo, impending geopolitical tensions, lack of recycling, and our current inability to expand the lifespan of a battery-powered vehicle past 10 years. Factor in also the infrastructure changes that it will require to install charging stations in it to every gas station in America or New Zealand. The article goes on to say that despite all this, because EVs produce half the emissions of vehicles powered by fossil fuels overall, they are a benefit to our climate, but they are not a panacea to the world's energy problems, and that more research is needed. Really? That's their concern? It's worth destroying people's health, putting their safety at risk, destroying environments in other parts of the world, abuse of child and adult labor practices, destroying communities, and all the other problems I haven't even mentioned, to save half of vehicle emissions in a few countries that actually care about such things? Unbelievable. Our New Zealand government wants us to save the planet through using low-emission vehicles, no matter how much it harms those in lower incomes and the economy as a whole. Yet we can't lose our trade with countries like China, that rarely have blue sky days as the pollution is so bad. China also needs to secure clean water supplies in other countries, like New Zealand, as theirs is becoming undrinkable. And they don't know the meaning of universal human rights. Our government makes it increasingly difficult for our farmers to make a living with all the cow fart taxes and other regulations, and now, with a planned extra tax on their petrol and diesel vehicles, it could prove too much for some, leaving our farmland open to foreign buyers. But I digress. To be clear, I am concerned about the environment, but I do not limit my concern to the atmosphere alone. We need clean air to breathe, clean water to drink, clean land to live on, and a safe, non-exploitative human environment. I feel at best this government is virtue signaling at how green and good New Zealand is, while we are helping to destroy environments elsewhere in the process. I've outlined some of my concerns with the government's proposed plans to subsidize EVs and to add taxes to petrol vehicles. Please do your own research and talk to those around you. Let your representative or MP know your concerns about the hidden environmental costs of EVs, as in New Zealand, they will be voting on this proposal very soon. I'd like to add that it is very curious indeed that the damage caused in the production of these vehicles is rarely, if ever, discussed by the media. The silence of the media in this and other world issues is something else to talk about with friends. If you have found this video helpful, please like, subscribe, share, and discuss in the comments section below. Thank you.